Hi, I'm Tom Lee, Vice President of Engineering for Airpot Corporation. Today we'll be demonstrating an Airpot, an air damping dashpot, and the differences between what we call push damping and pull damping. Air is a great damping medium for low force, low energy applications because it is non-contaminating, can work without seals, and is stable over a wide temperature range. First, before demonstrating the dashpot's performance characteristics, let's just take a quick look at the dashpot outside of the demonstrator. We start with a precision bore cylinder made of borosilicate glass. Then an ultra-low friction graphite piston is closely fit to the cylinder to minimize leak without using seals. An adjustable restriction tunes the damping by precisely controlling the rate at which air flows in or out of the cylinder. We attach a connecting rod to the piston that accommodates misalignments between the dashpot and the mass being damped. The damping force is caused by a pressure difference from one side of the piston to the other. Since the rod side of the piston is open to the atmosphere, it is always at atmospheric pressure. When the piston moves, pressure on the other side of the piston changes, creating the damping force. Airpots work differently depending on whether you push or pull on the rod. Here, we've mounted a Model 240 dashpot in a demonstrator so you can see how it works in the pull direction. The dashpot controls the fall of this 2 kilogram mass. Initially, the pressure inside the dashpot is the same as outside the dashpot. As the weight falls, the pressure inside the dashpot drops below atmospheric, creating a partial vacuum. Now, let's look at an effect we call the air spring. The column of air inside the dashpot acts like a spring because air is compressible. When the dashpot starts from a fully retracted position, there is a relatively short column of air when the motion begins, so the air spring is stiff and the damping force rises quickly. The load travels only a short distance before it's controlled. This makes pull damping ideal for applications where it is desirable for the movement to be controlled for the entire stroke and the load is always reset to the starting position. On the other hand, if the dashpot is not fully retracted when the load is applied, the air column inside the dashpot is long and the damping force rises slower, making the moving mass bounce on the air spring or even crash against the stop. Pull damping has a load limitation because the pressure in the dashpot cannot drop below full vacuum. This means that the damping force can only approach atmospheric pressure times the surface area of the piston. If the bore diameter is too small for the applied force, the load will not be properly controlled. Now, let's take a look at push damping. With push damping, the pressure inside the dashpot is initially the same as outside the dashpot, like pull damping. But as the weight falls, the pressure inside the dashpot rises above atmospheric pressure. The air spring effect is much greater because the piston starts in an extended position and there's a relatively long column of air inside the dashpot at the beginning. This makes the air spring less stiff, so a significant distance is traveled before the falling mass is controlled, causing the mass to bounce on the air spring. This makes push damping less than ideal for applications where it's desirable for the movement to be controlled for the entire stroke. But with push damping, the air spring effect is reduced if the load is applied when the dashpot is mid-stroke because the air column is actually shorter. This makes it ideal for applications where the main goal is to reduce the final impact at the end of travel. No matter what the position of the dashpot is in when the load is applied, the landing is fairly soft. When a push dashpot is used beyond its recommended force limit, it can still work, but the air spring effect will be greater. Thank you for watching this demonstration of push and pull damping.